us to this deen of Islam. And I witness that Allah is the only God, He's the only one who is worthy of our worship. He is the one who installs people in authority and the one who removes them away. He is the one who provides life and the one who provides death. And I witness that Muhammad, may the peace and the blessings of Allah be upon him and upon his descendants until the day of judgment. I witness that he had received the revelation from Allah and that he had conveyed the message of Islam in the best manner a man could ever do. يقول الله عز وجل في كتابه العزيز في آيات المحكمات من سورة الحج إن الله يدافع عن الذين آمنوا إن الله لا يحب كل خوان كفور أذن للذين يقاتلون بأنهم ظلموا وإن الله على نصرهم لقدير الذين أخرجوا من ديارهم بغير حق إلا أن يقولوا ربنا الله ولولا دفع الله الناس بعضهم ببعض لهدمت صوامع وبيع وصلوات ومساجد يذكر فيها اسم الله كثيرا ولينصرن الله من ينصره إن الله لقوي عزيز. In this ayat, Allah Azza wa Jal, He establishes a major principle. A major principle that serves as a guideline for humanity then, for humanity now, and for humanity all the way until the day of judgment. A principle that Allah Azza wa Jal wants to preserve and wants to provide utmost security for places of worship, for places where people seek refuge whenever their life is at threat. Whenever their security is at threat, Allah Azza wa Jal wants to maintain certain positions where the people can resort to. وَلَوْلَا دَفْعُ اللَّهِ النَّاسَ بَعْضَهُمْ بِبَعْضٍ If it was not for Allah Azza wa Jal to provide the support and the victory, for some people against some others, then the result will be the destruction. لَهُدِّمَتْ means destruction or destroyed. لَهُدِّمَتْ صَوَامَ وَبِيَعْ places of worship. بِيَعْ means again, like churches. لَهُدِّمَتْ صَوَامِعْ وَبِيَعْ وَصَلَوَاتْ صَلَوَاتْ means places where prayers are established وَمَسَاجِدْ and mosques. يُذْكَرُ فِيهَا اسْمُ اللَّهِ كَثِيرًا The name of Allah Azza wa Jal is raised high. وَلَيَنْصُرَنَّ اللَّهُ مَنْ يَنْصُرُهُ Allah will provide victory for those who provide victory to Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah is indeed the most powerful. Allah indeed is the most dignified. Although the beginning of the ayah, it says Allah provides victory or pushes one people against another, but at the end he provides that Allah is the one who provides victory for those who support him. In other words, Allah Azza wa Jal, he guarantees the security of people. He guarantees the fact that people will not have fear, that no one will inculcate fear in the hearts of the people, only if those who provide support and victory to Allah Azza wa Jal, those who stand on the good path of Allah, those who stand and along the lines that Allah Azza wa Jal drew for humanity, those who follow the guidance that is revealed by Allah Azza wa Jal, those once they are established. In fact, the next ayah says, الَّذِينَ إِن مَكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةِ Those, once we establish them firmly in this earth, أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةِ They establish the prayer. وَآتَوُ الزَّكَاةِ They give the zakah. وَأَمَرُوا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَنَهُوا عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ They enjoin what's good and forbid what's evil. That is the principle that's laid down in the Quran. And every time there is a violation of this principle, every time someone who is in charge of the security of the people, someone who is not according to the path or lines of and guidelines of Allah Azza wa Jal, once he becomes, is in charge of the affairs of the people, then the security of the places of worship, and then the security of the people will be violated. And mind you, when Allah Azza wa Jal says, when the masajid are no longer safe. If the masjid is no longer safe, that means everything else is not safe. If the masjid or the church or the synagogue or the place of worship is being attacked, if it's being targeted by someone who is in charge, by anyone who has the power, if he targets a place of worship, it means that he leaves nothing behind. If the one who is in charge, with his rockets, with his planes, with his destruction weapons, if he attacks a masjid, and he kills people in a masjid, or in a church, that means he had not left anything behind. That means no hospital will be safe, no school will be safe, no street will be safe, no home will be safe, no one will be safe, no matter where, if the places of worship are targeted, because that's the last place. When people, and I give examples, when people find that their life is in jeopardy, when there are attacks on their homes, think of the people in Syria these days, when they run away, when they run away from their villages, they go to a masjid. They hide in a masjid. They go to a masjid hoping that those who are after them will not target the masjid. But then the masjid is destroyed. Then the masjid is hit. That means there is no more security. That's when Allah Azza wa Jalla in Surah Al-Hajj, when He says, وَلَوْلَا دَفْرُ اللَّهِ النَّاسَ بَعْضَهُمْ بِبَعْضٍ لَهُدِّمَتْ صَوَامِعٌ. If it was not for Allah Azza wa Jalla providing this utmost support for the people who deserve to be in charge, then everything else is at stake. Then every security is breached. Then every right of the human and the people is violated. Then the masjid is no longer safe haven. Then even Al-Baytul Haram will no longer be safe. Al-Baytul Masjid Al-Aqsa will no longer be safe. And the places where the people hide out every time their life is in jeopardy, those places will no longer be safe. And when we look around today, and this was a topic of a lecture I had today at Henry Ford College, when we look around today, the people in general, in the world at large, they cry out for security. The people of the world, look at Myanmar. Look at the Muslims in Myanmar fleeing the place in Burma. And their homes are destroyed. Their farms are being burned. Their trees are being uprooted. And their trucks, when they move out, they get destroyed. If they leave 10,000 people, barely 1,000 or 2,000 will make it to the other side of the river or the other side of the border. Look at the people in Syria. Look at the people in Afghanistan. Look at people in Pakistan. Look at people in Africa, in Mali. Look at the people all over the world. Look at the people in the schools here in this country. When you send your child to a school, at the end of the day you receive a call that your child has been hit by a gunman. When you go to McDonald's or someplace, somebody gives you a call that your wife has been killed there because someone outrageous. There is no safety, there is no security. People are looking for something that provides them security and safe haven. That's what the people want. That's what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a hadith when he says, "Man bata aminan fi sirri." Whoever goes home, amin. Amin means he's secure. He feels safe. Nothing is threatening him. There is nothing, absolutely, unless there is a judge who goes after you based on a legal, just matter. Someone will take you because of a violation that you have made. That's your problem. You have to pay for that. But if you are at home, and then a bomb comes to your place. If you are at home, or going out in the street, and someone outrageously hits you, even leave alone those guns. If you are driving, and someone who is drunk, who has lost his mind and hit you and kills you and kills your family, that's no security. The number of people who die every year because of these things that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made them sacred. See what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Islam made sacred. Allah, number one, man bata aminan fi sirbihi, you have to be safe. Mu'afan fi badani, you have health, you are healthy. عنده قوت يومه, you have food. Those are things that no one whatsoever there is should be deprived of. No one ever should be deprived out of food. No one should be deprived out of good health. No one should be deprived out of security. That's what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says. Not only that, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made my security, my life, my blood more worth than the Kaaba itself. The Kaaba, the one that we make Hajj to, Baytullah al-Haram. إِنَّ أَوَّلَ بَيْتٍ مُضِعَ لِلنَّاسِ الَّذِي بِبَكَّةَ مُبَارَكًا. Allah blessed it. Allah made it big. Allah made it from أَعْظَمُ الشَّعَائِرِ وَمَنْ يُعَظَّمُ شَعَائِرَ اللَّهِ فَأَنَّهَا مِنْ تَقْوَى الْقُلُوبِ. He said, this is to make greatness, شَعِيرَ from Allah عز وجل. Al-Ka'bah, nothing is greater than Al-Ka'bah. Nothing is more sacred. Nothing is better except one thing. The blood of a Muslim. The blood. The safety. The security is more sacred. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was making tawaf around the Kaaba and saying, "Ma a'zamaki, ma a'zamaki, how great you are, wa ma atyabaki, how good you are, wa ma a'zam wa ma atyab rihaki. You smell so beautiful. Waladamu al-Muslim a'zamu hurmatan 'inda Allahi minki. But the blood of a Muslim is more sacred than you are, more sacred than the Kaaba itself." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made it that way. Allah azza wa jalla accepted it to be that way. But today, the blood of the Muslim, not only the Muslim, even the Muslims, we are not only picky about the Muslim. The world in general, but in particular, the blood of a Muslim is spilled day and night without any cost. Not even more expensive than the bullet that hits him, leave alone the Kaaba. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made it more expensive, more costly, more important, more greater than the Kaaba. But today, it's not even as costly as the bullet that hits the person. We bleed from inside, we tear, our eyes are full of tears. We shiver every time we hear something, especially these days, the unknown, the disturbing, the amount and the massive destruction and killing that goes in that part of the Sham, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Aqwa daru Islam al-Sham." This is the end of the end, where Islam will eventually be, will be lasting. It's in that place of the Sham. And Muslims are doing, it's not that Muslims are doing nothing, but they are incapable. See, the most serious problem that impacts a person, the most thing that hits you, when you see the wrong and you feel that you are crippled, you want to do something but you don't know what to do. You want to help but you have no means of help. You want to save someone, something, but you feel that you are absolutely locked down, you can't do nothing. That's the most annoying, disturbing. This past year, I remember the case when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he came under the attack from that movie that came from California, from some of the people, the Christians. We're not accusing all the Christians, but it's a person who did that. And then when you look at all of this and you want to do something, and you are crippled, the only thing you can do is cry. The only thing is you raise your voice. But there comes the time when the Ummah at large, you look at those Muslims fleeing Myanmar, Burma, and you bleed from inside, you look at their pictures. Sometimes you can't even look at the pictures because they are so abusive. And then inside your heart, you feel that you can't do nothing. It's as if you are seeing your own child in front of you passing away or dying because of a disease, and you are unable to bring him that medicine that can cure him. You know he can be cured, but you cannot get that medicine. You know there is a doctor that can do something, but you cannot call that doctor. You know that. You know there is a cure, there is a solution, but it's out of your reach. That makes you very angry from inside. That makes you very unpleased from inside. And that's what the Ummah is in today. That's the situation we know. The Ummah, the wealth of the Ummah is far greater than any wealth anywhere else in the world. But we are unable to stop the persecution of one Muslim in Myanmar. We know that the Ummah, 1.5 billion, is far greater and stronger. So strong, Ummah. Very large. We're able, we have the oil, we have the gas, we have the land, we have the men, we have the money, we have the doctors, we have the engineers, we have the industrials. In the United States alone, there are more than 150,000 Muslim engineers who are working in all types of corporations, very strong ummah. But we cannot stop the destruction machine for one day, for 1 hour. That's what the situation of being weightless, weightless without weight. That's what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also said in one hadith: "Satada'a alaykum al-umam kama tada'a al-akalatu ala qas'atiha." The umam, the nations, will invite one another against you, will chop one piece from here. Iraq today, Syria tomorrow, Kurdistan the third day, Afghanistan yesterday, Pakistan tomorrow, Bangladesh, Myanmar. To take this piece, take that piece, chop this piece, and all of that going on. كما تداعى الأكلة على قصعتها, as if people are inviting one another for some food, for some dish of biryani or some other type of food. Inviting one another, come eat this, come eat that. Then the Sahaba of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم were saying, أو من قلة نحن يا رسول الله, is it because we are so few? Said, لا لا لا, no. بل كثير, you'll be many. ولكنكم غثاء كغثاء السيل, but you'll be like the foam flowing on top of the river. الغثاء, الغثاء is the weightless type of weed that is carried on top of the river when the river is moving, and there's all types of weeds, weeds, wood, grasses, leaves, dry leaves, they are on top of the river, and then while the river is walking, it will be shifted to the side. Weightless. It's not part of the river. Doesn't have weight. ولكنكم كغثاء, غثاء كغثاء السيل. ولذمن ولنزعن الله المهابة من قلوب أعدائكم. And your enemies, the people of your foes, will have no fear of you whatsoever. Will not even count you. At the time, you all remember, when sometimes when Israel decides to go into Gaza, it's a free ride. To them, it's a free ride. Their place, they come, they bombard, they leave. Do they take any account for 1.5 billion Muslims, what they are going to do to them? No, of course. They may, in their background, what the United States would say, what Britain would say, what Europe, what Russia, they can look at that if they have a green light. Now, these days, when they say there is this whole conflict with Iran, if Israel has a green light from the United States, they will bombard Iran, there is no problem. But they don't wait for a green light from the Muslim world. Because the Muslim Ummah doesn't even have the light to put on. Neither green, nor red, nor yellow, nothing. غُثَاءٌ كَغُثَاءِ السَّيْلِ. And the end result of all of this, where does this all lead to? It leads to one main conclusion, what Allah Azza wa Jalla said in Surah Al-Hajj, which I started with. If the people of Islam, the people of Quran, that Allah Azza wa Jalla gave them the last guidance, the thing that should provide security and food and health and all justice for all mankind, rahmatun lil alameen, if those who have this mercy, those who have the responsibility for providing the mercy for the world, if those who have the responsibility of the Quran, those who have the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that was revealed to Muhammad, peace be upon him, those are asleep. Those are not up to the standard. Those are not up on their feet to provide that justice and mercy to the world. How could they provide it to themselves? They cannot. And they did not. And for the last almost 100 years, the Muslim Ummah have been going out from one conflict into another conflict. From despair into other despair. From torture to other torture. From poverty to other poverty. And the resources of the Ummah, which are the largest in the world, have not been able to feed the poor of the Ummah. More than 50% of the poor people of the world, 90 people of the world are Muslims. There are 850 million people today who are suffering from lack of food. They don't have food to eat. Half of them are in the Muslim world, are Muslims. At the time when the Muslim money, the money of the Muslim Ummah is flooding the banks over Switzerland, the Bank of Britain, the Bank of America, the Bank of all of this world. Only last week, there was this conflict. Anyone we heard about the conflict in Cyprus? The banks of Cyprus are going to take 10% of all the money that's deposited in their banks. Guess who has the most money hidden in the banks of Cyprus? Muslim money. Muslim money. I mean, Muslim money, it doesn't matter. The owner, whether it's Abdullah or Muhammad or Ali or Abu Bakr or whoever, Muslim money. Is that our money? Hundreds of billions of dollars deposited in banks so they will not be used in their own country, in the countries of Islam, when more than 400 million Muslims are poor and hungry. Isn't that what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us again in a hadith, and I will conclude. مَا مِنْ أَهْلِ عَرَصَةٍ يَبِيتُونَ وَفِيهِمْ رُؤُنْ جَائِعٍ. Any group of people who go to sleep, يَبِيتُونَ if they go to bed, وَفِيهِمْ رُؤُنْ جَائِعٍ, there one person who is hungry, إِلَّا بَرِئَتْ مِنْهُمْ ذِمَّةُ اللَّهِ. بَلِئَتْ مِنْهُمْ ذِمَّةُ اللَّهِ. The dhimma, the ahd, the covenant of Allah Azza wa Jal will disassociate these people. It's us. It's us, not only talking about this community here, the few Muslims in this masjid. Us as a ummah. We as a ummah, we have failed to stand up for our responsibility in front of Allah Azza wa Jal. We have not taken this call in the Quran seriously. Whenever a masjid is destroyed in Syria or in Iraq or in Iran or in Pakistan or in Afghanistan or in Egypt or in Tunis or in Myanmar, wherever, when any masjid is destroyed and people are killed, the Muslim Ummah is responsible. We have to answer for that. When any place that's been destroyed, innocent people, their life is taken, Allah Azza wa Jalla will ask us, why did not you bring that mercy which I provided to your Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Why didn't you work to bring it up so that the people would live in mercy and peace and justice? Why did you fail that responsibility? I sent you the Prophet among you, the best Prophet. I saved this Prophet for you, the last one, the best messenger. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I gave you the Quran, I preserved it. There are many books that I revealed before I did not preserve. But I preserve the Quran for you. Inna nahnu nazzalna al-dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun. Allah vowed to make it, to protect it. This Quran, subhanAllah, for more than 1400 years. We challenge anyone in the world to find another Quran like it. Or another copy, or another version. It's preserved. I did not preserve it, you did not preserve it. It's beyond my power to preserve something for 1400 years. Allah did. Allah preserved the Quran for us. Allah preserved it in the Sunnah. He made among this Ummah Bukhari, Muslim, and Nisa'i, Abu Dawood, great scholars to come and filter out the hadith and document them. We have the whole thing. No one in the world has a complete system that has been preserved for so many years. No one, absolutely. Not the socialists, not the communists, not the capitalists, not the democrats, none. The only ones who have a complete system, well documented, well written, well preserved, well established with examples, is us. Us, no one else. The socialists, they tried their socialism for 50 years and they collapsed. They could not. The capitalists, they lived for a while and they made a big mess in the world. They don't have something to resort back to. We do. We do. But we went back, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, that you have come to love your life more than love the hereafter. وَلَيَقْذِفَنَّ اللَّهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ الْوَهَنَ. There is wahan in us that we started looking for the dunya as if it's everlasting. And we know it's over. We know there is an end to the dunya. May Allah Azza wa Jal enable us to look back one more time into that thing that we have, into that Islam, that Quran, that this Quran has a complete way of life for us, for the rest of the world, for everybody looking for it. Everybody in the world, the child, the mother, even the birds, even the animals, they want to enjoy the life that Allah Azza wa Jal gave to them based on the guidance revealed in the Quran. We have to look back and read it and comprehend it. And remember and bring it up. Because that's a responsibility upon us from Allah Azza wa Jalla. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله عز وجل. Alhamdulillah, may all the praise be to Allah. I just want to reiterate the hadith that I spoke in the first khutbah and leave us with it, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, "Man bata at to Adam, his home, to his home, with mu'afan fi badanihi, he is healthy, he has what it takes to maintain his health, he has the health security, عنده قوت يومه, he has the food for that day, he has food security." Those are three types of security that are must. Those are principles of Islam. The health security, the food security, and the physical security. Without them, Islam is not serving us. Islam is not serving the world. Islam came in order to protect those values for the human. And that is something we are proud of because we believe in them, but we don't take the pride because we lack them. We are proud internally, but we cannot announce that pride because we lack them and the world around us lacks them. اللهم إني أسألك في هذا اليوم العظيم أن لا تدع ذنبا إلا غفرته ولا سبيلا إلا محوته ولا خطيئة إلا وضعتها اللهم اغفر لنا الذنوب التي تهتك العظام اللهم اغفر لنا الذنوب التي تبدل النعم اللهم اغفر لنا الذنوب التي تجلب النقم اللهم انصر المسلمين بالإسلام يا رب العالمين وأعز المسلمين بالإسلام إنك أنت العزيز الحكيم ومن ابتغى العزة عند غيرك فلا فأذله يا رب العالمين اللهم يا الله إني أسألك في هذا اليوم العظيم وفي هذه الساعة المباركة وبفضل هذه الأطفال واليتم والنساء والشيوخ يا رب العالمين وبكل من له حق عليك يا رب العالمين إني أسألك أن لا تمكن طاغية سوريا من البطش بامرأة ولا طفل ولا رجل ولا مسجد بعد هذه اللحظة يا رب العالمين اللهم انصر المسلمين يا الله اللهم من علينا وعلى العالم أجمع بقيام دولة الخلافة الراشدة على منهاج النبوة يحكم فيها بكتابك وسنة نبيك وترفع فيها راية الجهاد في سبيلك يؤمر فيها بالمعروف وينهى فيها عن المنكر يا رب العالمين اللهم ارحمنا فإنك بنا رحيم اللهم ارحم والدينا وكل من له حق علينا اللهم ارحم امواتنا واموات المسلمين اجمعين واغفر لنا انك انت الغفور الرحيم وصل اللهم على محمد وعلى ال محمد كما صليت وسلمت على ابراهيم وعلى ال ابراهيم في العالمين انك حميد مجيد واقم الصلاه ان الصلاه تنهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي ذلكم لعلكم تذكرون وذكر الله